Come on down. There are some seats over here, and this is a nice, intimate place. So please don't, anybody, if you have to get up for any reason or want to cross in front of me, I'll just pretend I don't see you. Don't sweat it. Let's see. Okay, so I've been introduced. These are my bona fides. I'm legit. This is a picture of me actually this last summer in Montana. Actually, no, this was Idaho. We flew into Montana for the eclipse. So I have an AB, not a BA. If you go to a hoity-toity institution like Dartmouth College, they will tell you that is an Artium Baccalaureae in Latin, so I technically have an AB. I have a master's and a PhD in geological sciences from Brown University. I was an administrator for 14 years, as well as a researcher, and these were not concurrent, so as it says, please don't do math. Okay, so these are the topics that I plan to cover, but if I get to a point where you're like, we'd rather talk about this, this can be fluid. In my defense, it was Halloween when this picture was taken. For those of you who are a little bit younger, this would be the older Star Trek uniform. So first I'd like to talk about why we are interested in Mars in the first place. I assume that I have a friendly audience, but it's important to go over why we're spending a lot of money to study another planet. I'm going to talk about our avatar on Mars, one of them at least, that's the Curiosity rover. There are two. Opportunity is on the other side of the planet, and it is still going after, what, 14 years into a 90-day mission, so I'll introduce the instruments a little bit, and then I'll talk about the science. So, why go to Mars? This is a fair question, and I, like you, I'm a U.S. taxpayer, and I would like to know that the money that my taxes are going to support things that are going to make a difference in my children's lives. In my life, yes, but those of us who are parents and grandparents, we know that our focus tends to change when we have children. So, a quick aside, a story. Yes, please.
Could somebody dim these lights a little bit?
Yes, I think I was told how, but I'm not sure. Thank you. My fault. It's the one, what we need is the one above here, and I'm not sure which one that is.
Not sure about that.
That's the one you got your hand on.
That one?
Yeah.
I don't
know
what
that okay? The back. I would do the ones in the back also.
Hey,
too much?
No, perfect. It was perfect.
That was
a Midwestern exclamation of joy. So.
Okay, say when.
Well,
I need to know about the video.
If you well, go any further, we're not going to see any pictures
right.
Coming from the cameras.
Let's try this for a while, and then if we have to demo more, we will. So, as I said, a story as an aside. About a month before Curiosity landed, I was working with some friends of mine from the JSC, Johnson Space Center in Houston, who were out in the field. These gentlemen were engineers. I was the geologist. And as a typical geologist, I was already down on the ground fiddling with some rocks or some dirt or something. And I don't know if it was because they were talking over me, so somehow, like you're in the doctor's office and you're lying down and they think that if you're lying down, you can't hear them. So I'm down here, and they're talking over me about the landing, and they say, what do you think? I don't know. Man, that sky crane is pretty crazy. Yeah, I give it about 50-50. This is my livelihood, right? These guys, I don't know, 50-50, it might crash, we don't know, right? Which is totally understandable because the audacity of this mission, the entry, descent, and landing of this mission was absolutely audacious. So we landed successfully, as you know, And 5 minutes into the celebratory, right, celebration, everybody's on their computers, right, or they're checking their phones, and I got an email from one of these guys, and this is what he sent me. Okay, now I'm going to tell you why we're going to Mars. So, for those of you who are interested in exploration, Mars is the next step. Mars is the next step into space. We are incredibly fortunate as a spacefaring species to have a moon that is so close. The moon is 2.5 light seconds away, meaning you can have almost real-time communication, essentially real-time communication with anyone that's on the moon as long as you have line of sight. Mars is, on a good day, 40 light minutes away. Right? So it is significantly more challenging to get there, but it is definitely the next step. It's not boiling hot, like lead melting hot, like Venus. It's cold, but it's got an atmosphere. That makes it a little more difficult to land, but it also makes it much more interesting for us as atmosphere breathers. Mars helps us better understand Earth-like environments. I'm going to talk about that in just a minute. But for a geologist like me, for anybody who's interested in rocks or anybody who's interested in landscapes, Mars has a lot that's familiar and a lot that's unfamiliar. And that lets us ask some really important questions. So when we talk about Earth-like, what do we mean? For those of you who have studied geology at all, you know that even Earth was not necessarily Earth-like for much of its history, meaning it was unable to support the kind of life that we picture. Right? There are several planets here. Some of them are moons, technically moons. They orbit another body. But we have Titan. This is a moon of Saturn. It has a very thick atmosphere, actually one of the recent proposed missions to Titan was a drone. And if you have a drone, you have to have a pretty thick atmosphere for those rotors to work. These dark areas are actually liquid. So Titan has seas. They're liquid methane, but oceans nonetheless. This is Europa in the middle. Europa has an ocean as well. It's just completely underneath its ice crust. So all of those dark lines that you see on the surface are, we believe, areas where that crust has split apart and water has come through. Water that is enriched in all sorts of briny kind of things that are in solution. So one idea has been, if you wanted life, one place to look might be under that icy crust. That's Enceladus. That's another moon of Saturn. Enceladus also has an icy crust with water geysers that erupt. They're water volcanoes, essentially. If you're a geologist, water is just a rock-forming mineral, right? Ice is just another rock. And so it would make perfect sense that in a cold environment, you'd have ice, you'd have water volcanoes. But Mars kind of stands alone among these planets, among these bodies, as ones that we're interested in. And one of the main reasons is because in the past, and even occasionally, and I'll point out some areas where this is true, currently, there are geologic processes that we're familiar with that we would see on Earth. So there are plenty of volcanic lava flows on Mars. There are sedimentary effluvia. We just talked about that, so thank you for asking that. There were glaciers at one point. We don't know how big, how extensive they were. Aeolian, that just means wind, so picture dunes, picture sand. Impacts, those are the craters. Mass movements, that just means anytime you have a landslide or stuff moving downhill due to gravity. So volcanic features, this is Olympus Mons on Mars. Olympus Mons is 3 times the height of Mount Everest. So the edifice itself is the size of the state of Arizona, and the caldera, this is where the lava used to come out, is the size of the state of Rhode Island. Both, incidentally, states I've lived in. Very, very large, right? So if you're flying in a plane and you're flying by Olympus Mons, two-thirds of the mountain is still above you. On the other hand, the shape is very similar to what you see in the background there. That, for those of you who've been to Hawaii, that's Mauna Loa. Mauna Loa is what's called a shield volcano. And that means that the lava that comes out is very low viscosity. It runs very easily, runs for long distances, and builds up this beautiful shield. The shape is almost identical. You could put one on top of the other, and the shape is almost identical. And in fact, if you measure Mauna Loa from the seabed to the top, the height is actually pretty similar. So what happens when you don't have plate tectonics? Moving plates away from some place where there's a hot spot of volcanism, you get something like Olympus Mons. It just keeps building and building and building. But the rocks that make up these two mountains are pretty much chemically the same. Here are some lava tubes. This is one in Hawaii that's a friend of mine. These are lava tubes on Pavonis Mons. They don't have the crust over them, but they're still lava tubes. We talked about sedimentary rocks. These are two classic sedimentary rocks. One is on Earth over here on the right. The other is on Mars. They look almost identical. This is what's called a conglomerate. And a conglomerate happens when you have rounded river stones that are picked up by a large flow, a large catastrophic flow, and mixed up with a bunch of small sediment as well, and jumbled up around and dumped somewhere, and then lithified by pressure or cementation or both. And you can see that even the scale bar is the same. So what that tells you is that here on Mars, somewhere, you had a process that was able to round these stones significantly, right? And typically the only thing we know of that will do that on Earth is water, right? You run a stone along a riverbed long enough and it knocks off the sharp corners and edges, and the sand in there kind of smooths the stone out over time. So that had to have happened. And these had to have been transported somewhere. And then the whole mess had to be transported with a bunch of other small grain stuff, dumped somewhere else, then dropped down, come out of solution, then lithified. All of that had to happen, not on Earth, but on Mars. We've known for decades that there are these beautiful channels on Mars. We have good data now that confirms that these were formed by flowing water. And Mars is actually, in a very small way, an active planet. There are still things going on. These are gullies. Different areas that were taken, images that were taken in 2010 and then 2013. And you can see this area here, right? Here it is in 2010, here it is 3 years later. So something is active, and what we think is happening above, those are gullies in Iceland. And so in Iceland, what will happen is you'll have an ice layer underneath this rock or soil there. And if you get a cliff face, the sun will shine on that ice layer, the ice will melt. The layer above it, when the ice melts, gives way and opens up these gullies. And so you'll get debris, but you'll also get water flowing down. And that's what we think might be happening here. There are multiple theories, hypotheses is a better word for that, but that is one of them. So if you have small grained stuff, sand, and you add wind, you often get dunes. And in fact, the shape of the various dunes on Mars are ones that we are familiar with on Earth. And here are two dust devils, one in the state of Arizona, and one on Mars. You can see it in the distance there. And this was taken by the Opportunity rover. You can see the Opportunity tracks right here. Here are two dust storms, one on Mars, that beautiful mushroom cloud shape, Here's that same mushroom cloud shape coming off the Horn of Africa, right? Here's Spain right here, coming off the Sahara. You get the same type of airflow, you'll get the same type of storm shape. So that was at the very large scale. Even at the very small scale, we see similarities. So these are actually two pictures that I acquired, one on Mars, one in Oregon on Earth. This one I was actually present for. But you can see the open structure of the rock in both cases. These are both scoria, which is a very specific type of volcanic rock. Excuse me. So let me just wrap that up in a little bow. So I've shown you how Mars has a lot of similarities to Earth. And that's all very interesting. But why necessarily do we care? Well, Mars has a lot of similarities and a lot of differences. That provides us context about our own planet. So for example, you would never go see a doctor that had only seen one patient. That doctor would not necessarily know the proper questions to ask. That doctor would not necessarily know what's normal and what's outside normal. In the same way, it's difficult for us to know what's normal for a planet and what is outside normal without looking at that planet in context. And planets like Venus, planets like Mars, other planets in the solar system allow us to understand what that context is. So, is plate tectonics as a process, is that unusual? Well, we can actually answer that. We know to ask the question, in part because we've seen and looked at and studied other planets. And we now start to have answers to that question as well. Yes, it is unusual. It's very unusual. And it might be one of the reasons that life is sustainable on this planet. Okay, so let me introduce you to the rover. The rover's job is not necessarily to find life. The rover's job is to find out if Mars at once could have supported life. And the vast majority of scientists are looking for, could it have supported microbes? We have no evidence that Mars once supported anything, anything at all in terms of life, which suggests that if it did, that life would have had to have been very small. This is where we are. Other places that we have been are in yellow. So just to give you a perspective here, this is not half the planet, this is the entire planet. This is a particular projection that allows you to kind of squish and stretch the whole planet so you can see it all at once. South Pole, North Pole, here is Olympus Mons, actually, a couple other volcanoes in a row. Phoenix up there, Viking 1 and 2, Pathfinder, 1997, Spirit and Opportunity, both launched at the same time. Spirit, unfortunately, was much further south, meaning it got a lot colder and we were not able to sustain her. She was run on solar power. But Opportunity is closer to the equator. She is still running. And then Curiosity. Why did we go to Gale Crater? Okay. Crater is just a big hole in the ground. Something big struck the planet, left a big hole in the ground. Why did we go here? Oh, and the circle, by the way, that was our landing ellipse. I'm never quite sure where we're going to land because the atmosphere can do funky things. It's not like the moon where you can kind of do pinpoint landing. The atmosphere plays with your spacecraft a little bit. So that's the landing ellipse. The idea is to land somewhere in that ellipse, which we did. But you can see that we have a big mountain in the middle of the crater. That mountain is actually made up of different rock layers. Those rock layers must have been laid down, and then covered up, and then eroded away near the outside, right? But the rock layers stayed because they were protected by the rim of the crater. Why are rock layers important? Well, anybody who's been to the Grand Canyon, I'll just ask. Waha! Excellent. Good. So you remember all of those individual rock layers. each of those rock layers is important because each one represents a different environment, possibly a different process, but a different environment, different geologic environment, different conditions under which those that rock formed. So the more rock layers you have, the more past environments you can sample. The bigger your stack, the further back down into history you can go. And unlike Earth, where you have lots of twisting and turning and plate tectonics and things riding up over other things and so on, and you don't always know if the layers that you see have been overturned or not. On Mars, we're pretty sure, because we don't have to deal with all of that activity, that those layers, right, the older ones are at the bottom and the younger ones are at the top. These are mock-ups of the different rovers that we have landed on Mars. And this is the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. For those of you who have seen the movie The Martian, you can see that it is vastly different than what you might have seen in that movie. And that is because the Jet Propulsion Laboratory is funded by taxpayer dollars. And so all of those bells and whistles would be totally cool if you're working for SpaceX, but we would rather put our money into rovers than into fancy buildings, which is why it looks like Tomorrowland. But my friends at JPL don't always realize that not everybody has been there. So it is difficult to know what the scale is here. How big are those stairs? There's not even a trash can to know. So I have put myself in so you can get an idea of how big the rover is. So this rover is actually about the size of a golf cart. These are the solar panels. Sojourner here, which I've just covered, sorry about that, is about this big. A couple of bread baskets, I guess. It has a solar panel on the top. This is Curiosity. Curiosity actually runs on nuclear power. It has a plug about the size of a pencil eraser, and that will power it until about 2020. Some of the instruments we use, these are the eyes of Curiosity. There are two of them so that the rover can see in stereo. And for those of you who are of the younger persuasion, all this means is that it allows you to see, gives you depth perception. So if somebody's throwing a football at you, you're able to see how far away it is, right? So if you want to test your own depth perception, you can focus on your on the background and watch your finger move against the background as you go back and forth. And that's because each eye looks at that finger from a different angle. Right? And when they come together, that gives you a sense of perspective. That gives you your 3D sense. So the rover has two eyes so that we can basically see in 3D. You'll see they have different apertures, though. Each one sees has a different field of view and a different resolution. So one of them has a much smaller field of view, but a better resolution. The other has a larger field of view, but a coarser resolution. So sometimes we need the one because we can get pictures quickly, nice, pretty colored pictures quickly. We can get an idea of where we are. Sometimes we need the better resolution, but it means we have to narrow down and pick what we want to take pictures of. This hat on the top is actually the chem cam, the chemistry camera. So the chem cam takes what are called laser-induced breakdown spectroscopy data. And that just means that it is difficult to get the chemistry, the composition of a rock, just by looking at it. Right? It is difficult for me to take one of our mass cam pictures that I just showed you and figure out what a rock is made of. What I want to do is be able to get inside, get into the chemistry. But that actually turns out to be really hard to do with a picture. But what you can do instead, and this is an artist's conception, you can't actually see the laser, but the laser shoots the rock, creates a little bit of plasma, basically turns it into a gas. The rock goes from solid to gas. And the gas is actually easy to measure. So ChemCam measures the gas that comes off of these different rocks when we shoot it. And that allows us to get a lot more of an idea of the composition from a distance. some other instruments. If you've ever seen the weather report, this is how we judge the weather on Mars. Those are the REMS booms. They're run by a group out of Spain. EAPXS on the left, this is a contact instrument. It can tell you what elements are in each of the rocks that it comes into contact with. And these two instruments are actually inside the rover. And their job, the rover has an arm and is able to drill into the rock, take a sample, and give each of these instruments part of that sample so that we can look for organics.
Question.
Yeah.
If you now you're going to take another sample from another place, you have to purge those containers?
There are a certain number of containers. We clean off the drill. And we have a certain number, we have a certain number of drill bits, but we have a certain number of samples that we can take. So we're limited. Yeah. This is my camera. This is the Mars Hand Lens Imager. And the idea behind this camera is to be able to look at things at the millimeter to submillimeter scale. So that's what you're looking at over here. It's just a handful of sand, right? Taken somewhere in California, which is why it's not nice and smooth, it's all rough, because the camera was built in San Diego. But the camera allows us to see all those individual grains. So anybody who's, you know, kind of passed out on the beach, looking really closely at the sand grains, right? You know, it's a sleepy day and you've been playing and it's warm, and right? But you'll see different colors, you'll see different shapes, you'll see different sizes. All of that information tells us something about what that grain is made of and how it got there. How they're put together in a rock tells us something about how that rock was formed and what kind of features we might see in that rock, whether you know, grains are kind of sorted by size or shape or not. All of those things tell us something about how that rock was formed. But let me point out a couple of things on the camera. You can get an idea of the size here. On the top, you'll see what looks like a hinge in the back that is actually a hinge. There is a dust cover. Mars is a very dusty place. And there's a dust cover on the camera. And so every time we take a picture, we flip the dust cover open to take a picture. Inside also, you'll see little holes, two sort of rectangular holes and two circular holes. There are LEDs along the camera edge, so that we can take pictures at night if we want to, or illuminate the surface if we want to. There are UV lights. We haven't seen anything fluoresce yet, but never know. So this is unfortunately the first picture that we ever took with my camera. This was taken, I think, on Sol 12, 11? A Martian day is referred to as a sol, and this is because we have people who are working on Earth but are working on Mars simultaneously. And the Martian day is actually 24 hours and 37 minutes long, so they don't coincide. So you always have to refer to which day and which planet you're talking about. So if I'm referring to a day, I'm referring to a day on Earth. If I refer to a sol, it's a day on Mars. So what happened here? Does our camera stink? What did we do? The Mars rover, Curiosity, is by far the most complex semi-autonomous spacecraft that we've ever made. We've sent people right to space, and that's a different bear altogether. But for semi-autonomy, this is the most complex beast that we have ever made. And the camera was not quite as complex as the rover chassis, so it got finished before the rover chassis was done. And there were changes that were made as to how our camera would be mounted on the end of that big 2-meter arm. The arm is 2 meters long, so we're 6 feet long, 7 feet long, and it weighs 100 kilos. Humongous. It's got five joints. It's just a massive, massive thing. And so the camera, at one point, was sitting one place sitting another. And we ended up getting mounted kind of cockeyed slightly facing out. So the camera is all kind of, you know, the arm is tucked in like this, but the camera was facing out towards the landing plumes. Now, of course, we had that lovely dust cover, but the dust cover was supposed to be transparent. Our plan was actually to be able to take images through the dust cover until the dust cover got too grungy, and then we'd start opening the dust cover. But the idea was to save as much of the camera wear as possible. There's your camera wear. And at this time, we did not know, because it hadn't been tested, we did not know if that was just the dust cover we were looking through, or if the dust cover had disintegrated, and that was our lens, and the mission was over for us. We had no idea at this point. So about Sol 31, mass camera turned the favor and took this picture. And I'm not going to show you the picture of me and my boss hugging each other, tears running down our faces. But there's our camera looking back at us, just like a teenager, like, what? I'm fine, what? Okay. You can see the lights are on, right? So we were testing the LEDs at the time. And you can also see the size of this turret, right? For a while it was called the Cheesehead for obvious reasons. It's actually the size and the shape of one of those Cheesehead hats. Having lived in Green Bay, I promise you, this is very big. But there it is, healthy as can be. This is the arm in action. And again, it's got five joints. So one, two, three. There's one over there. We've got the turret here. And watching it move, and I don't know if this is going to let me play the video. Sometimes it does, and sometimes it doesn't. Nope, not this time. Okay, well, anyway.
How did you get that picture looking back at it?
Oh, so that's the mast cam taking the picture. So remember those two eyes that I showed you? That's the mast cam taking a picture of the turret. And actually, the mast cam does that every time we use the turret in a semi-risky way, just to take a picture and make sure everything's still okay. So now I'm going to show you some pretty pictures of actual science. One of the cool things about working on the MAHLI camera is that it is this camera that has kind of put the finishing stamp on, was there water on Mars? How active was that water? This rock is the miniaturized version of the conglomerate that I showed you near the beginning. You can see sharp corners, right? But some of these little grains, these are tiny, tiny grains, right? Here's a 5 millimeter. These are itty bitty grains, but some of them are rounded. Some of them are not. So it's a whole mix. It's a whole grab bag of stuff. But this one, you have grain to grain contact, and you have these little divots that have been knocked out of that particular pebble. Why is that important? Those are all things that happen when you have fluidized flow. It doesn't mean that you necessarily had nothing but water, but it does mean that that sediment got mobilized, got that movement started through a mix of this sediment and water. That grain-to-grain contact is exactly what we see right here. Little grains right, knocking right together. So we just talked about Penquid Point with someone. Is Betty still here? She said, ah, ha, ha, there you go. Okay. So these are the shales you might see at Penquid Point. These are very, very fine-grained rocks, very fine-grained. This is a mudstone on Mars. And this sequence that you're seeing here is the sequence that you might, that we typically take. So the camera will be 100 centimeters or excuse me, 25 centimeters from the surface. And at that, we'll get an image like this, right? For those of you who are interested, that is 100 microns per pixel, right? Which means that things that are half a millimeter or more, we can resolve them. We can say something about them. But this gives us context into where we're going to get right down into the grain sizes. This is a 5 centimeter offset, means the camera's only 5 centimeters from the surface at that point. And you'll see that there's one in there that says 1 centimeter, and I'll talk about that in a second. But this 5 centimeter image is important because at 5 centimeters from the surface, our camera is taking a picture at 31 microns per pixel. That's an odd number. 31, not 30. Not 35, 31. Why? Because Spirit and Opportunity both had a microscopic imager, but that had a fixed focus. The focus wouldn't change. So every picture that's in focus from those cameras is at 31 microns per pixel, exactly. So if we take these 5 centimeter images, it allows us to compare from one point of the planet to the other directly without having to go, the resolution's not quite the same. I gotta like play with it in Photoshop or something. We also take 2 images at that point, slightly offset, again, so that we can look at it in stereo. The 1 centimeter image is our closest approach, and that is exactly what it sounds like. This 7 foot, 200 pound, 5-jointed arm will get 1 centimeter away from the surface.
About a half an inch or less.
About that, to take a picture. That's how good these women and men are at driving this thing. It is astounding to me. It just astounds me every time. It gives me a little happy thrill. These folks are fantastic. I was once asked, what was it like to live on Mars time? So the first 90 sols in the mission, most of us were out in Pasadena, we were at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, and we were living on a 24-hour and 37-minute day, 24-hour, 37-minute clock. So sometimes I was coming in at 3 p.m., sometimes I was coming in at 4 a.m., sometimes it was dark, sometimes it was not dark, always the shades were down, so you didn't have those clues until you went out to get your car. But I was asked what that was like. And I was sleep deprived, but I was surrounded by people who were the best at what they did and loved what they did and were driven to do better every single day. So it was a little like college, I guess, right? Surrounded by people who love what they're doing and everybody's sleep deprived. So 1 centimeter gives us 17 microns per pixel. 17 microns per pixel. So you can easily resolve the texture within your hair. Right? So this is very close. Why is this important? This image is one of the crucial images of the mission. And that's because MAHLI was designed to be able to discern between very fine sand and silt. Now, yes, as a geologist, you actually have numbers to put to those terms, right? There's a whole scale, and you can classify grains based on that scale. So very fine sand is 62.5 microns in diameter or more. Anything less than that, we can't resolve with the camera. We did that on purpose. So that if we can resolve the grains, they're sand. If we can't resolve the grains, then they're silt or smaller. And silt or smaller, the prime hypothesis for how silt would be created into a siltstone or a fine stone or a mudstone is through settling in a lacustrine environment. That means a lake. So settling out of suspension is how you get grains this small to turn into a rock. And so that's why this image is so important for our mission, because it tells you that Gale Crater was once a lake. Yeah?
How do you know that it was water versus some other fluid?
Good question. There are no other candidate fluids for which we have geologic evidence. So for example, there, the place that we're in right now is called Hematite Ridge because there's a decent amount of hematite signal from orbit. Hematite is a mineral that requires water to form. There's water in the matrix. So the rocks left behind typically have clues to whatever fluid it is that stirred them around, because there are chemical reactions that occur when you have minerals and a fluid come together. And the only fluid that we have a great deal of is water. This is Newport Ledge. This is near Ogunquit Beach. This is, in fact, still Mars. All beautifully polished from Aeolian activity, sandblasting. For those of you who haven't seen it, this is one of my favorites. This is Chamberlain Rock. But you can see, that's why I love this rock, actually. Beautiful different layers in this rock. And every layer, again, even at this small scale, every layer has a story. Some Aeolian wear, all these little pits. You can see the, you can actually start resolving some of these grains. You can call out different grains. You can see how they've been creating these little pits, different types of wear. And yes, I've really made a point to stick with the Bar Harbor plot, so we've got some good names here for you. So let me show you where we are now. This is the Bar Harbor plot. We were in the Bar Harbor plot for a significant amount of time. All of the targets in the Bar Harbor plot were named for geologic units or features or other important features in Maine. Right now we're sitting in the Torridon Quad. Those of you who've been to Scotland, all of the names that we're currently playing with, and let me tell you what, boy howdy, there were some folks who were complaining about the difficulty of pronouncing some of those Maine names. They thought they had it bad then. Now we're talking Celtic names, so half the letters you're like, could be me, could be Kate, don't know. All right, so this is just for fun. This is, I'm going to show you the first selfie in space. This would be Aldrin, Buzz Aldrin, taking a picture of himself. This is a little more recent from one of the space shuttle missions. And this is one of our self-portraits. I love this picture because it took me 80 sols to finally work it through the system. Remember how I said I spent 14 years as an administrator? That helps you know how to work the system. It took me 80 sols to do it. But I had a couple of people who planned the software and put the sequence together. And here it is, 81 pictures by the Mars hand lens imager, one after the other, put together, knitted together as a mosaic, and this is what you get. Oh, and so here is one of the arm hinges. So if anybody says, clearly it wasn't taken on Mars, the arm isn't there. Yes, it is, right? We just masked out parts of the arm so that the picture would look better. If you want to see all of them, you don't believe me, you can go to jpl.nasa.gov. All of the pictures are downloaded there. This is just another self-portrait. You can see that we're getting even better at it. So the lighting is better here, and we can actually look at the underside of the rover. This has some serious use because it allows us to take the rover's temperature. How's it doing?
What camera is taking that picture?
That's our Mars hand lens imager on the end of the arm, every single picture. But again, we've gotten really good at putting that mosaic together. Knitting it all so it looks beautiful. There are a couple of places you could probably see the seams, but they do a really good job.
What kind of a day is that? I mean, I can see reflection. Is that a sunny day on Mars, or particularly typical cloudy day on Mars?
It is most days are sunny. Most days are sunny. This is a typical Martian day. Typical Martian, let me look at the shadow here. Afternoon, I think. Early afternoon, because that's the best lighting for this particular one. But it's like anything, right? Just like on Earth, you want to see where the sun's coming from, take a look at the shadows. Yeah, go ahead.
So you said the camera station is on the arm and Photoshop out the arm.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So every image we take to get one of these self-portraits has anywhere from a 10 to a 60% overlap with another image. And that allows us to, right? So one's going to be taking it at this angle, one's going to be taking it at that angle. So you get this bit there and that bit there, and you can just use the one that has the background that you want. I'm going to throw that up in case anybody wants to look at every single image we ever produce. But I would also very much like to take questions. Yes.
So if you said there's always sun, why did you use what a nuclear cell, and which has an expiration date, as opposed to solar panels, which might have lasted longer?
Excellent question. So you remember how much larger Curiosity was because of the mission that the mission objectives that we had. That meant all of those instruments inside the rover. And it meant this humongous arm, and it meant all of the instruments that are mounted on that turret. All of those things require power. And our solar panel technology is not sufficient to run that size rover. So that's why Curiosity and the Mars 2020 rover that is currently in production will have to run on radioisotopic thermonuclear power.
In terms of time on the planet and distance traveled, where is Curiosity in terms of its original mission and where is it going next?
Let me give you a map. That's probably the best one. So we started in the Yellowknife quad up there at the top. I'm trying to see, yeah. So there's a scale bar down here. I think we've gone, I think we've passed the marathon mark. But every one of those yellow quads are quads that we've gone through. And now we're here. So the Hope, you remember that mountain that I showed you in the middle? That's this way, right? So we landed on the northwest side of Mount Sharp, which is down here. We're headed this way to climb that mountain. We want to get as high up as we can before we die. The idea being, again, the further up we go, the more layers we can sample, the more of Mars's history we can tell. So we'll just keep climbing the hill until we can't climb it. Yes, here, and then I'll be right to you.
The photograph that I gave for our child, the rock wall. Can I go to the website? This is a Curiosity photograph that's on the back cover of last year's annual report for rock wall. Can I go to the website, find this map, and track down which quadrant that photograph was taken?
The easier way of finding any particular target is to just do a Google search. And that's because again, we've got a certain amount of taxpayer dollars, yeah. And we don't put it into user-friendly, believe me, user-friendly interface. But if you go to, let's see, I think we were in Bar Harbor somewhere around Sol, in the Sol 1200s. If you go to the JPL website and look up around Sol 1200, 1250, you'll start to go through all of our targets there.
Okay, great.
Yes, Henley.
At that side of the corner, the very bottom, is that the mountain that you're going towards?
Yes, sir. Yes, it is. So the question is this the mountain we're headed towards? Yes. And our big concern here, you can see it starts to get kind of rough, right? And if you remember, you'll see here, that's a big hole in the wheel. And let's see if I can find one of the other ones. There's some big honking holes in these wheels. We're a little concerned about that. The engineers assure me that the wheels, once we lose one of the wheels, we still have I think, 10 years of mission life, and we don't expect to live that long. But the rougher the terrain, the more difficult it is to climb it. Yes?
As a taxpayer, how do you feel about sending humans to Mars?
As a taxpayer and as a scientist, I love the idea, and I'll tell you why. As a scientist, everything that I have shown you today could have been done by a person and a graduate student and their graduate student in a weekend. So the efficiency of people once you get them on the ground is far and away, you know, even with all of the instruments here that humans, I mean, our rover sees in ways humans can't see. I would love just 2 or 3 days. Answer me this. As a taxpayer, sending people to the moon was far and away the greatest impetus to the economy over the last 30 years. Because every bit of miniaturization of electronics comes from trying to fit those electronics into the Apollo capsule. Right? Now we're at the point where your phone could easily run the Apollo capsule, which is astounding. But it started because we were desperate to be able to fit some electronics into these, I think Alan Shepard called it trying to put a banana back in its skin. These things are 7 feet tall and you're trying to cram a 6 foot guy in. It's ridiculous. But there are two things historically that greatly further technology and thus the economy in a short amount of time, and it's war and space travel. And I think that space travel is the better investment. In the back.
As a capitalist, how do you feel about sending Parker's novel?
Say again, please.
I said, as a capitalist, how do you feel about sending Parker's novel to the Mars?
Oh, dear. All right, someone's going to have to...
Overstar.
Oh.
I actually wanted to say Todd Hoffman.
So...
actually, even on a more serious question...
That's fine. Because I would just say, if I had the choice, I'd send me, but I have kids. So.
But on a serious, more serious question,
sure.
Can you go to your Iceland 2013 slide?
Yes, I can. Give me a second. Go ahead and ask your question while I get there.
Well, just wait till the picture gets there.
Yep.
Seriously, when you're looking at those two pictures there, there's much similarity there. I want to question if you're trying to pull the globe over her eyes, okay? I believe you, okay?
No, there is a lot of similarity here. So what I said was there's some activity, right?
Yeah.
It is, again, let's look at this in context. Mars in context of Earth is dead, right? There is no question. But has there been some activity? You bet. And this suggests to you that this is a channel that's been reopened over the last 3 years. Now, it's only 100 meters. These are not huge, right? Do I think bugs are going to crawl out of this? No. But the fact that you still have some volatilization, meaning stuff is going from solid to gas, or even liquid to gas, actually, volatilization, tells you that there's something trapped in the rocks that's coming out. And as a geologist, that's exciting to me. Now, you, as a layman, looking at this, there's not a whole lot going on. I'm not going to deny that. There's not. We're talking about Mars, right? The fact that anything is going on is kind of a big deal. Go ahead.
You mentioned earlier that the size of the unit of power
Pencil eraser. Yep.
And so it wouldn't have added much weight, would it, 2, 3, 4 times the size of the eraser, and have this operating for much longer? That's so part one of my questions. Mm-hmm. Part two would be, wouldn't it be great if somebody, the next group that goes there, can replace that pencil eraser
So let me answer the first one.
What's the question?
The question is, could we not have, since this was a small nuclear plug, could we not have put in multiple ones so that we could run the rover longer? So there are two answers, and we could have put a larger one, yes, that would have given us more daughters, parent-to-daughter product. But it is difficult enough in to have any nuclear power on any spacecraft. There are, excuse me one second, there's a lot of backlash and a lot of concern about launching anything that says nuclear in it into space, because you have to start on the launch pad on Earth. And there are people who don't want to see any nuclear product ever go into space. So the pencil eraser was below a certain threshold, and that made it something that we could deal with. Your other question was, wouldn't it be great if AAA would come along, basically, if the next rover would play AAA and replace the power pack? The answer, as far as I'm concerned, is yes, because I would like to continue working with this landing site. But what that means is that rover doesn't get to go somewhere else, and I would get to learn something else about somewhere else on Mars. And these are not cheap, so we have to be very efficient in picking the places that we go. I will tell you that the process of picking the landing site is a multi-year process. We still haven't picked the one for 2021. Yeah. Yes?
Apart from the laser spectroscopy, what was the other type of analytical instrument you use? Are you doing whole rock data there? Are you getting whole rock there?
Right, so there's the LIBS spectroscopy, and then there's the APXS, which is alpha proton X-ray spectrometry, and that's a contact instrument. And so whereas the LIBS will give you, this is, you know, 60% SiO2 and 40% blah, the APXS will give you, you have 20% oxygen, you have 15% iron, you have whatever. So it'll give you the elemental abundances, but you actually have to come in contact or close to contact to be able to do that.
Okay. Standardless?
Say again?
Standardless analysis? Is the analysis standardless?
Standardless.
Like
oh, you mean do we compare it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. We've got a whole library, if that's what you're asking.
Yeah.
Yeah, comparative library. Anyone else? I keep here long enough. Thank you very much for listening.